Hello, David Zeretsky for the Bond Experience. Welcome back. I am joined by a very intriguing author, and we're going to chat with him today about something he created that really needs further exploration. And his name is Jeremy Duns. Jeremy, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, David. It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, this is fantastic. I'm intrigued because typically, as many audience members know, we cover a lot of things. We cover locations. Gosh, we cover style, the sartorial aspects, props, wardrobe, the movie. We do obviously connect to the literary Bond, but you did something with Ian Fleming that is almost historical in nature. Can you update us on what's your corner of the world, of the Bond world?
Well, my corner of the Bond world, I guess, is Fleming related stuff. I have written about the films, and I guess my corner is things that haven't yet kind of been explored that much. I'm interested in trying to find the kind of little nooks and crannies from the footnotes and stuff. And I really dug most into the literary side of stuff, especially Fleming's life, Fleming's kind of secret life, if you like, for example, that, you know, he was working for MI6 while he was writing the James Bond novels, which I don't think many people know too much about. Mm-hmm. But also how he kind of influenced the genre, the cultural impact of Fleming, because of course, without Ian Fleming, there would be no James Bond.
And so, I think some people forget that. I mean, we interview and talk to a lot of people that discovered James Bond through GoldenEye, the video game. And so there's a younger crowd that say, wait, stop me here. There are books behind it. Right. Yeah, but what I also loved about what you do, which we're building to, is in the Bond community, in the fan community, you've got your positivity and you've got your negativity. You've got your jealousy and you've got your admiration. And I think we forget, or maybe didn't even realize, that Ian Fleming, as a colleague in the literary community, had his share of both as well.
Yeah. So I wrote an essay about this topic. I actually wrote the essay in 2011. And about a week ago, I was looking for something on my computer, and I came across this, in a file on my hard drive. And I had deleted it. It had been up on my blog literally 9 years ago, but very briefly, and no one really paid much attention. And I looked at it again, and I thought, hold on a second, this is like, I did quite a lot of research here. This is, 11,000 words. This is longer than my, dissertation I did when I was at university. So what was I thinking, 9 years ago, that I went into this amount of detail? So I read it again and I thought, this is quite interesting. I think there's something here. And basically I had gone back and looked at the initial reaction to Fleming's work, which was extremely favorable. And he was kind of accepted, if you like, in the line of, this is going to be another Graham Greene, another Eric Ambler. This is going to be a guy who writes thrillers that are exciting, but they also have some class. There's also something more to them. And he was taken seriously, helped along, it must be said, by the fact that he himself worked for the Sunday Times. Mm-hmm. His wife, Anne Fleming, was a literary hostess, and he knew lots of writers and journalists. So there was a little bit, he was part of that world, part of that club. And initially, they welcomed him in, and then they didn't. Then the more successful he got, basically, they decided, we're not so keen on this guy anymore. And they attacked him really quite viciously. And the way I got into this was through, as I'm sure you know, Ian Fleming had several brothers. And one of his brothers, his elder brother, Peter, was a very successful author in his own right. He was a travel writer, Peter Fleming. And in fact, when Ian Fleming submitted Casino Royale to Jonathan Cape, who published Peter Fleming, Jonathan Cape, the head of the company, didn't like Casino Royale at all. And he said, I don't want to publish it. And he only published it as a favor, essentially, because they published his elder brother, who was famous. But for that, there might not have been a James Bond.
Thank you, Peter.
Thank you, Peter. But Peter, after Ian Fleming died, Peter kind of took over as a kind of protector of his brother's reputation and of the literary estate. And Peter Fleming was a real life James Bond. Ian Fleming didn't really see action during the Second World War, but Peter Fleming did. He was a commando. He was incredibly brave. he didn't have the Bond side that he was. I mean, he was married to a very well known actress, and he was married to her, you know, for a very long time. So he didn't have that kind of womanizing side of him. But he was, some of the stuff he got up to was extraordinary. He had an extraordinary life. He traveled all over the world, and he got up to all kinds of bizarre stuff during the Second World War. And I was reading a biography of him, a very good biography written in the 70s by Duff Hart Davis. And there was a bit in that about how Peter Fleming, who was very mild-mannered, he was a very calm guy, was enraged by a particular critic and how he had written a review in American Esquire 4 months after his brother's death that really attacked Fleming personally. It's very insulting about Ian Fleming as a person, and also attacks the books whilst admitting that he has only just read one, which is You Only Live Twice. And he got very angry about this. And I thought, that's quite interesting. And so basically my article, it's called Enemy Action after the expression in Goldfinger. And I'm essentially going back through where did this come from? And I've kind of traced how that chain, it was a kind of chain reaction of one critic kind of piggybacking on the other until they became nastier and nastier, until after he died, I mean, essentially anything went. And how that has kind of influenced the way that Fleming's seen now, especially in Britain, because I mean Arthur Conan Doyle is a revered creator of Sherlock Holmes. You know, in the US you have Dashiell Hammett and Raymond Chandler, yeah. Patricia Highsmith. These people are all taken very seriously, even though they wrote thrillers. But even though Ian Fleming created this, you know, world famous fictional icon who's still going today after 25 films, he's not seen, you know, he's below stairs, as we say. He's not seen in the same way. And I think it comes down to this kind of thing.
Well, you sparked a few questions in me. So we know that there is, and this is almost legendary, there is a real cliche that things that become popular almost automatically cannot be revered, you know, to a high, either literary or even film stand. I mean, look at the Oscars, you know, if you look at those blockbusters and you're craving for those, you're not going to find them at the Oscars. You're not going to find them revered by the critics. Now, what's interesting to me is you almost get that from the literary sense. So I think the Kennedy aspect from Russia with Love, the fact that he actually picked from Russia with Love, the book, as one of his favorites, allegedly and legendary, created a surge in sales and popularity. Now, did that create a lot of jealousy amongst the critics? Were they like, why am I not that choice?
Yeah, pretty much. It was accepted that Ian Fleming, you know, he's one of us. He's a member of, you know, he's a journalist. He's a writer like one of us. He can mix in these circles. You know, he was friends with a lot of these people. He was friends with Noel Coward and all of these people. And that's all fine. He's had a bit of fun writing a thriller. And we'll take it seriously when it's at that level. But right. When it's become globally famous, yes, we have an expression, maybe you have the same expression in the States, I don't know, but tall poppy syndrome, that you must, the taller the poppy gets, you have to cut the poppy down to size. And we really have that in the UK, that if you get too big, you're too big for your boots, no one's going to be interested, and suddenly you need to be taught a lesson, essentially. And yeah, there was a huge amount of envy involved. A lot of these people had written fiction themselves, or had aspirations to do that. And yes, it wasn't just something that was known, was reasonably popular in the UK. Perhaps they were okay by the time the Daily Express had comic strips of it. But by the time, I mean, Malcolm Muggeridge, who's kind of the villain of my piece, he wrote, I think, 4 or 5 different articles that are essentially the same article attacking Fleming. I think in one of them, which was just after Fleming died, he mentions that the publisher has said that there have been 18 million sales of Fleming's books. And so, you know, 100,000 maybe they might have accepted, but if you're selling 18 million books, then I'm going for you. And, you know, that's not, it's not deserved, and it cannot possibly be something that can really be taken seriously as literature.
In your research, how much of it was just, you know, this mob mentality of pitchforks and torches at the ready versus people observing Fleming in some of his interviews and this perceived or real kind of snobbery about his literary sense, and then eventually the creation of the movies? What's the balance?
Well, I think, ironically, snobbery was something that most of these critics claimed that Fleming was guilty of. And the most famous article is by a guy called Paul Johnson, which is called, let me get this right, Sex, Snobbery, and Sadism, I think it is. And those are the three.
Sounds like a good afternoon.
Yeah. And those are the three kind of things that people have leveled against him. And I mean, sex, yes, there is sex in Fleming, although there was plenty of sex in the thrillers before then. These people didn't read thrillers. This is the thing. They were not really qualified. I mean, I review thrillers and I write thrillers, and I know something about thrillers. But I mean, one of the guys I got to review Live and Let Die for quite a respected magazine, he was a, you know, professor of medieval English, and he hated it. But I mean, were there any thrillers that he liked? Did he know anything about the history of the thriller? And so a lot of them didn't really know the genre. So I think sex, you know, it's just a, that's a complaint that could have been made about lots of thrillers. And then the sadism, I think, is just completely inaccurate because the villains are sadists. You know, it's the same as the films. James Bond isn't a sadist. Obviously, the villains are sadists. That's also something that is has been in the thriller since, you know, the beginning of the thriller. You have to have a villain who's a bad guy, otherwise if he's not going to be scary, you know. And then the third one was snobbery, and in that article accusing Fleming of snobbery, it's an incredibly snobbish article about Fleming. It goes on about how, you know, he's basically not quite, he's pretending to be, you know, a bit more than he is, and he's not quite upper class enough, and he's a member of all of these kind of clubs, and what is he doing with all this kind of stuff. It's an incredibly snobbish article, essentially claiming that his snobbery is not quite snobbish enough. So yeah. it's a very strange mixture of ignorance and envy and bitterness and, you know, all this kind of thing, and also bandwagon kind of jumping that, you know, it became a popular sport almost to strike at Fleming.
So you've done so much research on this, and it needs to be said, since we didn't say it at the beginning, that but you mentioned it, you are an author of 5 books yourself, countless articles, you've been a part of medias and events. I mean, I read the ticker, it's incredibly impressive.
On my website,
I guarantee 5 books behind there are yours with your name on it.
Yes.
Did it do anything? I mean, as an author, you probably imagine, you know, did it hurt Fleming? And I don't mean just personally. Did it hurt sales, or did it actually create resonance around him?
It's difficult to say. I think perhaps a little bit of both. There would have been some people who would have been put off, and there would have been, but you know, the expression "there's no such thing as bad publicity" probably, you know, has something to it. He responded. He took the rare step of responding to one of the reviews, which was in The Guardian, and it's a very, which I quote in the essay, and it's a very long response, and it's a very kind of self-deprecating response, but at the same, and it's quite funny because I think he realized that he couldn't, you know, be a diva, that wouldn't look very good, so he plays it pretty cool, but at the same time he essentially points out these people have no clue what they're talking about. All of these complaints you could apply to any thrillers from before mine. But yeah, I think probably some people were put off by this. And I think Fleming, I think he had a thick skin, but I think it would have been difficult.
Yeah. It's interesting. I have to tell you something in preparation for this discussion that you and I had. I spoke to a relative of mine who's an older gentleman, so certainly old enough that he remembers buying and reading the paperbacks, you know, way back when. And one of the things that he said when he was reading an Ian Fleming novel, it was almost like somebody reading 50 Shades of Grey today. You know, you would take the cover off, or, you know, you wouldn't, on an airplane, you wouldn't hold it up to everybody. It was one of these kind of pulpy things that you would read and love and relish, but you would also keep kind of on the down low.
Yeah, it gave it, these kind of reviews gave it that kind of illicit glow, which I think that probably, yeah, his publishers and Fleming would have liked to a certain degree, because you don't want to write thrillers that are safe and that, you know, please fuddy-duddies. I mean, these were fuddy-duddies, basically. They were behind the times. They didn't really know about thrillers. So yeah, it did have a little bit of that kind of illicit feel to it.
What, Jeremy, what sparked your need? I mean, you're a creator. Authors, even YouTubers, you know, they need to create. They've got that yearn when they wake up in the morning. What made you want to write this article? What was the drive and the passion to do it?
Well, I suppose, you know, on a small level, I was reading this biography and I came across this thing and I was intrigued. And when I'm intrigued by something, I quite often I'm very curious and quite restless. I've written a lot about James Bond, and I mean, my specialty, I suppose, is bigger than this. I'm interested in espionage, the spy world in general. So all my books are about spying and espionage, mainly in the Cold War. So four novels about a British secret agent in the 60s and one non-fiction book. And James Bond, I mean, I'm a British male, so you can't escape James Bond.
It's in your DNA.
It's no, but I mean, if you're, it's everywhere basically. It's not so much in your DNA, but it just is everywhere growing up. And I remember, I think I must have been 14, my cousin gave me a John Gardner Bond novel. And I tried to read the Fleming novels when I was about that age, and I just couldn't get into them. They seemed very cold, a little bit incomprehensible. I was too young. I didn't really understand what was going on. They seemed very old-fashioned, and for me, James Bond was Roger Moore, and this guy was not Roger Moore. So I didn't understand it at all. And then Dalton came along, and I was a little bit too young for Dalton, really, and I didn't really understand what that was about. And then, of course, there was a big gap. I think it was 6 years after the second Dalton film until Brosnan came along, and in that gap, I kind of grew up, if you like. You know, that was because, you know, I was 19 or 20 when GoldenEye came out, and that kind of sort of struck right for me. By that time, I'd gone away. I'd read other spy fiction. I'd read John le Carré, I'd read Len Deighton. And so then I was intrigued. I mean, Pierce Brosnan seemed to me to be have been kind of designed to play James Bond. And so that re-sparked my interest in James Bond. I tried Fleming again, and I still couldn't get into him. It still seemed like there was no plot, there's no suspense. I couldn't they were very strange books to me. And it was only a few years after that I realized the mistake I had been making, which was to kind of come at it the wrong way, that I had been thinking that this was going to be like John le Carré or this was going to be like Len Deighton. And then I realized these are escapism, you know, these are fun, and they have fun with them. And once I kind of came at it that way, they opened up a lot. And so my motivation really is I'm interested in the huge impact that James Bond has had on the genre. You can't write about espionage, especially espionage fiction, without considering James Bond. It's just changed everything. And so how it's changed everything, it's a whole world of things that it's changed. And so there's so much to go into. You know, all of the novels, all the stories, Fleming's life, all the cracks in between. And my motivation as a researcher is always, I'm always interested in trying to find the thing that hasn't been found yet. You know, the thing that's kind of new. And this article isn't really that particularly. I've done some research in the archives to kind of find these reviews, but some of the other stuff I've done has really been trying to track down, you know, lost Bond novels, lost Bond scripts from the 60s, the script for The Diamond Smugglers, for example, the script for Casino Royale that was written by Ben Hecht, and all of those kind of things. So I'm always kind of trying to find, you know, what's the thing that hasn't been found yet, basically?
It's interesting too. As I hear your story and you as a character in your story, obviously, it almost seems like you've had a transformation of appreciation with the Ian Fleming novels. That particular story, I have to ask a question as an author. Do you find that the acceptance of that and appreciating, you know, his writing style in those moments, does it infiltrate? I'll use that term. Does it infiltrate your own writing? And in some ways, do you need to push out and go, I'm not writing a James Bond novel. Jeremy, stop.
No, absolutely. I mean, my series of novels are about a kind of bizarro Bond. He's a kind of bad guy Bond. He's an evil reverse image of Bond. So my idea was, I really wanted to write a 60s set spy novel, but how do you do this without making it, you know, not just imitate Bond and Fleming, but also all of the other people who are writing in those times? And at that point, I was very interested in the Bourne movies, the Jason Bourne movies, and how they had really kind of revitalized the kind of thriller movie kind of genre, if you like, and kind of injected new life. And they were extremely suspenseful, extremely exciting, but there was also a little bit something else going on. There was a kind of psychological thing going on, and they were smart. And they had this great twist, which is essentially James Bond has lost his memory. That's basically what they are. I mean, it's not a coincidence that the first two initials of Jason and the first two initials of Bourne are the same, because Robert Ludlum essentially, I mean, my theory is that he read The Man with the Golden Gun. No, sorry, he read You Only Live Twice, and You Only Live Twice ends with James Bond losing his memory. And then, of course, it gets it back in A Man with a Golden Gun. And it's kind of, it's very much passed off by Fleming. You know, he kind of, he just gets his memory back, basically. he's unbrainwashed.
Yeah.
But what happens between those two things? And I think Robert Ludlum thought of this concept, which is a great concept. What would that be like? Because Bond is undercover, and then he loses his memory. And what would that be like if a secret agent was undercover as another identity, and they lost their memory? In fact, he loses his memory in a similar way. He's knocked off a boat, and then you don't know who you are.
Right.
So he's taken that whole concept of the end of You Only Live Twice and made a whole series out of it. And so I thought, that's what I want. I want a twist like that. I want something that's Bond, like Bond, has some kind of similarity to this world, but that it can't just be a clone. There are many, many attempts to do this. And so the eventual thing I came up with was quite radical. What if James Bond, throughout his entire career, had secretly been working for the Russians, was a KGB agent? That's basically the pitch of my books. And they are influenced by Fleming, but they're also influenced by Len Dayton, John le Carré, Adam Hall. There's a whole kind of stew in there, and hopefully they have their own voice. But once I had read, this is my collection of nonfiction, but downstairs I have a couple of hundred spy paperbacks. And I kind of went on a jag reading lots and lots of spy fiction, especially from the Cold War. But then once I started writing, I kind of, like you said, had to step away and say, well, now I need to do my own thing, because otherwise it will just be, you know, a kind of, you will feel too much of that influence in it. I don't know if that answers your, that was a long-winded answer.
No. It's perfect. Because actually, you know, I'm going to, obviously, down below here in our comments, I'm putting the link to your article, Enemy Action. And I want everybody to read it, because it's a great read. But in addition to that, you know, as somebody who's kind of living and breathing this world of you know, literature, and if you were to suggest one of your books as an entry point, and this might be a duh question because you're probably going to say, oh, my first one to know the character, but which one should they pick up to really get to know Jeremy Dunn?
I would say, I mean, if you want to read a spy novel, then yes, my first one, which is called Free Agent, because you can read them in other orders, but that would make the most sense. And if you're a Bond fan, which I'm sure you are, if you're watching this, yes. The first chapter in particular is a kind of twist on the kind of Bond meets M scene, and you will recognize what I'm doing there. Start with that. If you're interested in nonfiction, I have written several kind of short books about James Bond and Ian Fleming, and I've written one which is kind of a compilation of all my articles, which is called Duns on Bond, which probably you have to sing to the tune of Girls on Film by Duran Duran. And that's that's where I've gone through. That's where I've done my kind of most of my research. So I probably say look at that.
Absolutely. We'll put up the associated links. I've got one more question for you. I've got to ask it, of course, because we're, you know, as we're doing this interview, we're just a few weeks away from a particular movie coming out. Do you get excited? Are you excited about No Time to Die? What's your feelings?
I am excited about it. I was watching your video about the song, the Billie Eilish song, and I kind of shared actually you and your guests' impression of it, which was, you know, initially slightly underwhelmed. And I think, you know, you called it a grower, and I think that's how I felt. But then also you mentioned this clip watching, I think it's 45, 46 seconds or something, this trailer with the music. And then when I watched that, then I felt like I was 15 years old again, because then this really, then that made me. There's something kind of primal about that reaction that you can't really imitate and you can't really recapture. And yeah, the thought of a, I mean, I love Daniel Craig's portrayal of James Bond.
Right.
I don't think he's necessarily had the best James Bond films, but for me, his James Bond is absolutely amazing. And so the thought of, I like this, the direction, the new director they have. I like the feel that I'm getting from it. Having, you know, Hans Zimmer, I mean, I'm excited by it. And also, you mentioned earlier that, you know, action, you know, kind of blockbusters don't really get the critical acclaim, but I mean, it's amazing in the last few years they have managed to do this. They have won Oscars, you know, the Bond films. It's kind of unthinkable. I mean, in the 60s, a couple of times, you know, sound engineers and stuff, but they are now kind of critically acclaimed films. They have managed to get, you know, really credible artists, you know, actors and all kinds of people. So yeah, and it's, I initially wasn't particularly happy with the title. I didn't think it was a great title. It sounded a bit kind of parodic. Or self-parodic, but no, I think I'm really looking forward to it. I think it's going to be a good one. What about you?
I'm excited. Yeah, no,
Yeah.
I'm all in.
You.
I am definitely team No Time to Die.
Okay.
It's
Okay.
and it's so funny. I was just producing this video the other day, which hasn't come out yet, around even the merchandise, and I am their target audience where just something comes out, you know, a little clip or, you know,
Yeah.
somebody sneezes into a James Bond tissue and goes, look, and I'm like,
Yeah.
yes.
Please, me. Yeah.
Yeah, because I do. You're right. I turn into that 15-year-old, you know, or 13-year-old when I discovered Bond, and it's so nostalgic for me too. And I'm so forgiving of the trips and, you know, the misses and things like that, that people just seem to, almost like Ian Fleming in Your Enemy Action, people just love to, you know, like hyenas just start to rip apart. And I just look at that and go, guys, this is our escape. You know, this is our escape valve in a very stressful life. You know,
Yeah,
have a little
but you,
positivity with it.
I mean, I think that's great, and I should say that, I mean, I've watched quite a few of your videos, but I'm not a collector. I don't have, you know, Tom Ford suits and that kind of stuff. But what I love about what you do is it's very enthusiastic and knowledgeable, but also very friendly and very warm, and it's the opposite of that. And I'm thinking that when I first started going on the internet to talk about James Bond, it was kind of, it was forums. And I think that that's a very cold, you know, now that seems quite old fashioned. I mean, people still use them, but the idea of me typing something here and then you replying in a few hours, typing something there.
Right.
And, you know, say we have a slightly different view of, I asked you, you know, what you think of No Time to Die. If you said, I'm not looking forward to it, purely reading the typing, I could go, what? How dare you? And it's a kind of, you can't see the other person, you can't hear the other person. And I think this whole thing that's developed with podcasts and YouTube channels and stuff has actually been a hugely positive development. Of course, there are, as you say, hyenas and people who are very negative
Sure.
and all that kind of stuff. But I think it's really great that you can connect with Bond fans who before, you know, 10 years ago might just have been strange names on a screen, not even their own names. You didn't know where they were. You didn't know what they looked like. You didn't know what they sounded like. And this is more like we're in a bar, you know, and it's very much harder to really kind of be that hostile and that aggressive when you're talking to someone. And so I think that it's, you know, YouTube channels like yours and all of these kind of podcasts and these kind of things have really helped a lot because the communication is so much easier and so much nicer when you do it this way. And so I, you know, so thank you for what you do.
Well, thank you. I mean, that's incredibly kind of you. And you know, I liken this, like exactly like you said, you know, two gentlemen that just are in a pub and one turns to the other and goes, so what do you do? Well, what do you do?
Yeah.
And they start
Yeah.
having a chat. Forms, you're right. I mean, first of all, there's that whole premise of, you know, keyboard muscles. You know, it's so easy in this faceless, robotic kind of cold of space where you could just say anything and everything. And very often it's a persona. I mean, you and I right now, that persona just starts to weaken and the shields drop. And
Yeah.
I think that's what's special about this.
No, absolutely. And I've definitely been guilty of that before. And I think also what's really wonderful about this is that it opens up so many more different things because, you know, I interviewed several years ago a writer who was really a fan of Tintin. And I think there are a few similarities. I like Tintin growing up, but I'm not an enormous fan. But this writer is a huge fan of Tintin. And I said, well, what is it that you'd like so much? And he said, well, to me, the whole world is in there. All life is contained in these adventures. And I think in a way, there's so many different aspects to the James Bond world that, you know, you're interested in, you know, the lifestyle and the kind of clothes and some of those kind of things. But and I'm more into sort of some of the, you know, quite obscure literary criticism and things like that. But there's room for all of this. And Absolutely. It's kind of opened up that people aren't kind of in their silos, and then you can learn from each other. Like I'm learning from watching your channel. Hopefully some of your viewers might learn something from listening to me. But you know, those are the kind of things where it's not the keyboard muscles, where it's not, and it's really, I've learned, it's taken me a while, but I've learned maybe over the last 10 years that, you know, you really need to get out of your comfort zone and listen and absorb what other people are saying and their areas of expertise. And I guess that's sort of how I came to James Bond as well, that I was a fan of, you know, spy fiction in general, but slowly, you know, I came to, you know, I was quite, maybe not snobbish, but I wasn't particularly interested in Fleming. And it took me a while to kind of listen and absorb and see where that could, you know, kind of fit in. So I think, you know, those are just good developments, I think.
It's amazing how entertaining listening can be. A lot of people like to talk, but listening, you're right. I call it fun education. But Jeremy, thank you. Thank you so much for this time today, spending your time writing the articles, writing the books. Again, we're going to put all the links up here. And again, thank you for the time. Really appreciate
thank you.
It.
Thank you very much, David.
This has been David Zritsky for The Bond Experience, and we'll see you real soon. Take care. Thanks for watching this episode. If you want to be up on the latest from The Bond Experience, just click on this subscribe and subscribe to our channel. You're going to get all the latest and greatest information, plus some exclusive content. And by the way, speaking of content, here's something especially for you, just because we know you. Talk to you soon.